David N. Saperstein is the ambassador at large for international religious freedom. He was confirmed by the Senate on December 12, 2014. He also heads the Office of International Religious Freedom in the Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. Ambassador Saperstein previously served for 40 years as the director of 40 years or 30 years? 40 years as the director of the Religious Action Center of Reform Judaism. He was educated at Cornell University and Hebrew Union College, receiving his JD from Washington College of Law at American University in Washington, D.C. He is a rabbi and attorney, and for 35 years has taught seminars on First Amendment, church-state law, and Jewish law at the Georgetown University Law Center. In 1999, Ambassador Saperstein served as the first chair of the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. In 2009, he was appointed by President Obama as a member of the first White House Council on Faith-Based and Neighborhood Partnerships. From 2011 to 2014, he served on the State Department's Strategic Dialogue with Civil Society as a member of its Religion and Foreign Policy Working Group. He is a prolific writer and speaker. Ambassador Saperstein has appeared on numerous television news and talk shows. His articles have been published in the Washington Post, New York Times, Harvard Law Review, and other places. His latest book is Jewish Dimensions of Social Justice, Tough Moral Choices of Our Time. Ambassador Saperstein's topic for this evening is U.S. efforts to promote international religious freedom. Ambassador Saperstein.
Thank you. Well, thank you for the introduction, and thank you for the work that the Wheatley Institution does. It is work clearly close to my heart in terms of the very concerns that I've had during my career, and I'm really honored to be here. It is not a burden whatsoever to be at BYU if you care about religious liberty. I am traveling all across the globe, and in virtually every country that I visit, I am meeting Mormons on missions, Mormons active in providing social welfare and social services to those countries. I have marveled at the ability of the Mormon Church to develop programs in each of the countries that works within the strictures of what that country permits. There are some religious faith groups that will push the envelope very hard to try and reshape the country in the short run along with the lines of what they think religious liberty calls for. The Mormon community manages over and over again to work out a decent relationship with the governing forces of a country, working within the strictures that they may face, but carrying out their core tasks in the process of doing it. It really is a remarkable gift, and they often are able to function easily and with more freedom than some of the other groups are able to do. And so it is always a pleasure. I meet with them to find out what their challenges are, what their needs are. There may be countries in which we have been approached by the church because people going on mission have trouble getting visas. We try to be helpful on that. But it is a long deep connection that we have with the church. So to be here at BYU, which houses the International Center for Law and Religion, Kol Durham is an industry in and of himself. I fly to the most isolated parts of the world to meet with beleaguered religious community, and the first question usually is, "Oh, do you know my friend Kol Durham?" He has really done some extraordinary stuff, as has the center, and Brett Scharf, and Gary, you're here now on behalf of the center, and Cole's work. You all should be commended. It's really an extraordinary institution, and all of us rely on it. I just want to acknowledge one other person here, because when I, if there are things I'm not sure of in international religious freedom issues, I call Cole Durham. If there are things I'm not sure of in domestic issues that I have to deal with, I call Alan Brownstein, who is a visiting professor. I walked in, you know, just I couldn't understand what he was doing here, far from his normal digs. And it's always an honor and a pleasure to see you. He's really a great thinker on some of the more vexing and challenging issues of religious freedom that we face here in the United States. So I am honored to serve as the United States Ambassador at Large for International Religious Freedom. Just to clarify, the term Ambassador at Large is a fancy title to suggest an ambassador who has global responsibilities. There are six of them at the State Department: global women's issues, global health issues, counterterrorism, drugs, human trafficking, and religious freedom. There are, however, I don't know the exact number, 60, 70 special envoys and special representatives, a different title, slightly different status, but work equally important, that deal with an entire range of issues, from climate change to arms control to 50 other issues that the United States is concerned about, who also have global responsibilities. It is part of the way that we structure the State Department. Most of the State Department is structured around regional offices and country-specific offices. But there are these thematic approaches that we need to have in order to further interests that the United States holds in a whole variety of urgent matters. And these special envoys, special representatives, and ambassadors at large are charged to do those that work on a global issue. As we look across the globe, we know that religious freedom flourishes in many countries. People are free to choose their faith, to change their faith, to speak about their faith to others, to teach their faith to their children, to dissent from religion, to build places of worship, to worship alone or in community with others who share their faith. And in such societies, denominations and faith groups organize as their leaders and members see fit. In those countries, interfaith cooperation flourishes at a level unprecedented in all of human history. Interfaith relations is a new phenomenon on the world scene, and we're blessed to live at a time when it is indeed flourishing, primarily in the freer countries, but often in countries where there are serious restrictions. And those interfaith efforts often are done at the risk to life, to limb, to resources, to safety. And this is an extraordinary phenomenon of which we are a part. But the truth is, in far too many countries, people face daunting, alarming, growing challenges on account of their beliefs. You know that every year the Pew Research Arm issues a study on global religious freedom trends. And in general, over the past 4 or 5 years, what it has found is that 3/4 of the countries in the world do not have serious problems of religious freedom. They got problems, every one of them, but not serious structural problems. 1/4 of the countries have very serious problems in terms of religious freedom. So the good news is 3/4, comparatively fewer problems, 1/4 a lot. The problem is, in that 1/4 are countries like China, India, Pakistan, etc. And 3/4 of the world's population lives in countries that have serious restrictions of religious freedom. And it is in these countries that we focus our strongest efforts, where the decision to live in accordance with one's conscience can literally mean life or death. In countries where we know what the major threats are to religious freedom, I think all of us know. Let me just mention very quickly, first, is the threat of the non-state actors that has arisen on the world scene in recent years. Daesh, ISIL, Al-Qaeda, Boko Haram. More people have been killed in the last couple of years by Boko Haram than all the other non-state actor terrorist groups combined. So Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab in Somalia. But there are militant Buddhist groups in Burma and Sri Lanka. There are militant Hindu groups in India. There are Christian militias in CAR, the Central African Republic. There are Jewish extremists on the West Bank in Israel. Every religion is faced with extremists who use their religion to justify the application of force, coercive force. Coercive force either in a form of direct violence from their hands or in the form of the fact that they are part of a majority and are you willing to use the coercive power of government to repress and persecute religious minorities in the world. It is almost always the minorities who are the victims of these issues. There are a handful of exceptions. Today, 15 years ago, I would have named three countries. Iraq, the Sunni, Saddam Hussein, the Sunni community controlling the majority Shia community. Syria, Assad's Alawite sect, and again controlling the majority Sunni in that country. And today, Bahrain, where you have a similar minority in imposing serious restrictions on the majority religion in the country. In the main, it is the minority religions who lose out. And certainly the restrictions and challenges that the Mormon church faces in a number of countries around the world is a perfect example of that. But we also face the existence of blasphemy, apostasy, and defamation of religion laws. These laws that punish people for making their core decisions about how they feel about religion in the way they live their life, leaving one religion, joining another, or speaking the truth about their religion, and the nature of that truth is offensive to the majority population. I mean, think about, for example, the Ahmadiyya Muslims. The assertion of the central tenet of their faith, that Muhammad was not the last prophet, is considered inherently blasphemous by normative Sunni Islam, and therefore puts them at risk for asserting the basic core principle of what they have. And it certainly closes down dissent of religion, criticism of religion, which is often characterized as blasphemous, or if not blasphemous, there are laws that prevent religions from being defamed, and anyone who dissents against what the majority religion is can often find themselves running afoul of those laws. There are today about a quarter of the countries, 47, 48 countries, that have blasphemy laws. Some don't have blasphemy laws, but laws that basically say every law of this country has to be in accord with Sharia law. So Afghanistan doesn't have blasphemy laws, but people get tried on the fact that that their action violates Sharia law here, and through the requirement that all actions of the government have to accord with Sharia law, they end up, in effect, being charged with blasphemy. So you have roughly a quarter of the world countries that have a number of them, minority of them, sizable, don't really enforce them. But of course, the fact that they have them leads to the people who do enforce them saying, why are you treating us differently than Germany? Germany has blasphemy laws. Why should Afghanistan, why should Pakistan be held to a different standard than Germany? And indeed, Germany, even in Germany in 2015, we had a case in which somebody tried under the laws was fined for having an anti-Catholic sign, an atheist, was fined for having an anti-Catholic sign bumper sticker on his car and was actually charged, convicted, and fined for having it here. Or you might hear, how do you come off criticizing us when there are six states in the United States that have blasphemy laws? Anyone know what the six are? Massachusetts, Wyoming, South Carolina, Oklahoma, Pennsylvania. I don't know how many that was, but that's close. Michigan is the sixth state. All have blasphemy laws. Supreme Court in the early 1950s said they are unenforceable under the First Amendment here. But every time I go and travel and talk to countries why blasphemy laws violate core components of the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights in terms of religious freedom, Article 18, or in terms of freedom of speech, freedom of expression, I get back, well, you have your blasphemy laws. Why don't you start at home? And at the point that I end my tenure, whenever that might be, Ambassador Lodge, I may just do that here to help out the next ambassador at Lodge. We shouldn't have such laws on the books, and we ought to do something about it. As the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedoms 2014 report states, blasphemy laws inappropriately position governments as arbiters of truth or religious rightness. They empower officials to enforce particular religious views against individuals, minorities, and dissenters that disagree. In contexts where an authoritarian government supports an established religious creed, blasphemy accusations are frequently used to silence critics or democratic rivals under the guise of enforcing religious piety. Or, as the remarkable former UN Special Rapporteur on Forbes is the international term for IRF. IRF is International Religious Freedom, the U.S. term that we use for this work. Forb is freedom of religion or belief, which is the European and more common international term for it. But as Heiner Bierfeld said in his 2015 report to the UN Human Rights Council, abundant experience in a number of countries demonstrates that blasphemy laws do not contribute to a climate of religion openness, tolerance, non-discrimination, and respect. To the contrary, they often fuel stereotyping, stigmatization, discrimination, and incitement to violence. Such laws have a stifling impact on the enjoyment of freedom of religion or belief, and it stifles healthy dialogue and debate about religion. Far too often, we see the use of blasphemy accusations as a weapon in petty interpersonal disputes. Individuals can languish in jail for years as a result of a blasphemy allegation in countries that really enforce it. And 12 countries have death penalty or life imprisonment for violation of blasphemy laws. We know of cases where blasphemy allegations stem from disputes over livestock grazing on a neighbor's land, over disputes over who owns what land, over one business person who wants to buy another's business who won't sell. He makes a blasphemy accusation. The accused ends up in jail and spends all their money defending themselves and gets forced to sell. Or one of the more common examples of this is resentment generated from romances between young people of differing faiths who run off together, and one family accuses the other of blasphemy. Consider the fate of an Afghan woman named Farkunda. In March 2015, as she made her way home from work as a teacher's assistant, Farkunda stopped at the Shamshira Shrine in downtown Kabul. She said her prayers and then felt compelled to preach a little truth to power in a very small and seemingly small and innocent way. She challenged the caretaker of the shrine, a man by the name of Zaidun, about the selling of charms at the shrine, which Farkunda believed was un-Islamic, violated Sharia law. The discussion escalated into an argument, and the caretaker then accused her publicly of being a tool of the Americans and having committed blasphemy by burning a Quran. There was absolutely no evidence whatsoever that any such thing had happened. A crowd quickly gathered to hear the incendiary accusations. Blasphemy is punishable by death in some interpretations of Sharia. And as I said, although there's no explicit blasphemy law, the Constitution states that Islam is a, quote, religion of the state, and that, quote, no law can be drawn contrary to the beliefs and provisions of the sacred religion of Islam. Farkunda denied the accusations and tried to defend herself from the increasingly agitated mob. Before long, a member of the crowd urged the mob to take justice into its own hands and kill her. Some of the police nearby tried to intervene as the crowd began to beat Farkunda and pull at her clothing. The police officers quickly gave up, however, and then watched mutely as the crowd tormented and killed its victim. She was beaten with sticks and boards, kicked, run over by a car, and dragged, thrown into a dry riverbed, stoned, finally set on fire as bystanders recorded the crime and police watched every act of barbarity. The medical examiner said she died in torment and pain sometime during the attack, but the crowd continued to abuse her lifeless body. Now, this is a particular heinous example, but one need only look at recent news stories to find the impact that these laws can have on people. Let me just mention a few of them. Saudi Arabia penalizes blasphemy, lengthy prison sentences and lashings. The entire world paid attention when in January 15, authorities publicly lashed Raif Badawi 50 times in accordance with the sentence that calling for 1,000 lashes for violating Islamic values, violating Sharia, committing blasphemy, and mocking religious symbols on the internet. Other poets, bloggers, and activists in Saudi Arabia continued to be charged and imprisoned under these laws. In Nigeria, in June 2015, a Sharia court in Kano had sentenced 9 members of a Muslim sect to death for blasphemy for allegedly elevating the group's founder above the Prophet Muhammad. In Pakistan, the government continued to enforce its blasphemy laws the death penalty, which often carry a death penalty for a range of charges, including, quote, defiling the Prophet Muhammad, unquote. Currently, more than 40 people remain on death row for blasphemy in Pakistan. While the majority of those charged with blasphemy are Muslim, a disproportionate number are members of religious minorities. Here in September, a 16-year-old Christian boy was arrested after he liked an allegedly blasphemous Facebook post. That was his crime, and he was arrested. He had to be rushed out of his hearing to local court when an angry mob appeared and called for his death, a frequent occurrence following these blasphemy accusations. Iran continues to execute prisoners of conscience for their beliefs. This included the mass execution of at least 20 individuals on August 2nd following convictions for what's called enmity against God. According to the Iran Human Rights Documentation Center database, at least 260 members of minority religious groups remain in prison, including Sunnis, Baha'is, Christians, Yarsanis, Sunnis connected with Yazidis in Iraq. Shia religious leaders who did not support the government's policies continue to face intimidation and arrest. And as I said, even in Europe, you have countries. We finally got Iceland. Finally ended its 78-year-old law this past year, its blasphemy law. Hadn't applied it for a long period of time. But we have held that up as a model, urging other countries to finally rescind their blasphemy laws. And we should also remember the heroic efforts of those who show moral leadership and are ready to stand up for those who would otherwise face persecution under blasphemy laws. We've heard of a lot of examples of that happening in Pakistan. One specific example that received a lot of attention: in July 2015, 3 Muslim leaders worked to quell a mob in Lahore after a group of people accused a Christian man of blasphemy for allegedly burning pages of the Quran. The imam of a nearby mosque heard about the rising tensions and immediately went to the scene to try and calm the crowd. He was joined by 2 other very prominent Muslim leaders from the community, and they physically stood between the angry mob and the Christian community until the crowd dissipated. And we have reports from civil society sources of a number of times that such episodes have taken place here. But, you know, too often the result is quite different. And finally, we have the category of government rules, regulations, and restrictions. I mean, I should say before going on to that, we've also seen the rise of anti-Semitism and Islamophobia in the United States, in Europe, escalating to alarming rates for Jews in Europe. There is the kind of attacks that have involved physical attacks on Jews walking on the street, attacks, firebombings of synagogues, attacks in Jewish cemeteries. Here, these are the kinds of things that we thought we would never see again after World War II, and they are happening again. And Islamophobia has taken hold as well. And one of the encouraging aspects is the number in Europe and the United States, the number of interfaith coalitions who, when these things happen, stand together. So those who have been victimized will not stand alone. If there's a mosque that's been desecrated, synagogue's been desecrated, a Mormon temple that should be a church that should be hit. I don't think a temple has ever, I don't remember a time that that has happened, but there have been episodes with churches that others in the community come together to clean up the damage done, to stand in solidarity with those who have been afflicted. It is really one of the extraordinary developments of our time. So the final issue are those issues that come because of government rules, regulations, laws, practices that are aimed at repressing religious freedom and limiting religious freedom, particularly, again, for minority groups. Now, these come in a number of different forms. Very strict registration requirements in countries, and there are many, many countries that have strict registration requirements. And if you don't register, either because ideologically it's a matter of principle, number of Baptist churches all over the world refuse to register because they don't think the government has the right to make them register. And every time they hold the service, they're in danger of having their pastor arrested, in danger of being shut down, in danger of being hit with a fine. And this is a central challenge. Jehovah's Witnesses in Central Asia, time and again, in Eritrea and in Russia, time and again being hit with fines simply for doing what they believe they have to do. And those fines mount up and they refuse to pay it. And they end up in jail because, as a matter of principle, they think they shouldn't have to pay the fines. So then you have, in many countries, another stage, not just registration, but recognition. In order to build a seminary, for example, you have to be a recognized faith, not just a registered church, individual church, but nationally recognized here. And it can take 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 25 years in order for faith groups in some countries to reach a stage where they would even qualify to be registered. I'll put aside when the government drags its feet about actually doing it. They don't even qualify. In Vietnam, you have to be functioning for 25 years before you can be qualified to be recognized. And I'll talk about Vietnam in a moment here as an example of these rules. And then there are the approval systems in which the committees on religious affairs, often part of the Ministry of the Interior, Ministry of Justice, that the Committee on Religious Affairs will require that any activity a religious institution has to do has to be approved by the government. It has to be approved this year and it has to be approved next year. So let me take Vietnam as an example here, and you will see why I'm choosing it in just a moment. In Vietnam, you have a very tough registration process, although, in truth, they have begun to ease it, including the Mormon Church, will finally receive national recognition as a church in Vietnam. This was a huge breakthrough, something that many in the international community have been encouraging for, including myself and my first visit to Vietnam. Here, this was an important development, but it took a long time of efforts to get there. But in Vietnam, if you want to hold a church service, You got to ask for government permission. You want to hold regular Sunday morning services, Friday prayers at the mosque, Saturday morning at the synagogue. You need to ask the government's permission. You want to celebrate Easter this year? You want to celebrate Ramadan this year, Yom Kippur this year, Diwali this year? You got to ask the government's permission. It has to be approved at the local, regional, and national levels. You want to send the kid to seminary? Kid has to be vetted and approved by the government. After completing their studies, you want to ordain that student? Vetted and approved by the government. Want to hire them in the pagoda, in the temple, in the mosque, in the church? You have to be vetted and approved by the government. The bishop wants to move the priests around because of the changing demographics and growing needs in another part of the diocese. Need to get the permission of the government. I was up in the Central Highlands just a few months ago, meeting with the bishop there. He said that is the thing that drives him most crazy. The hardest part for him is to get the priests where they have to go because it takes so long to get permission to assign the priests where they need it. So that's the situation as it sits today. But it may not be that way tomorrow. And I mean literally tomorrow. About 16 months ago, 17 months ago, Vietnam, responding to the passage of a new constitution, which required new basic laws in commercial law and criminal law and penal law and labor law and disability law and freedom of expression and freedom of protest, all of these laws had to be written, assigned the CRA the task of writing its first comprehensive law on religious freedom. And in the first draft of it, it did very little to expand religious freedom. But to their credit, they had a transparent process. They put it out for the response of the religious communities. And the religious communities told them what they needed and what was wrong with the current system. And they put it out for the international community to see. And so a number of countries began to give them feedback. We got the first translation of it the day before I was speaking to Vietnamese government authorities in our annual human rights dialogue. And I pointed out, other than it dropped that 25-year requirement to 10 years and gave a little more freedom for people who were in prison to have access to religious services, there wasn't a single improvement on any of the things that I talked about. And the ability of the government to limit religious freedom was on the kind of vaguest language of all kinds of, anything that might disturb the social order. I mean, anything could be defined as disturbing the social order. This is a problem we have in a lot of countries, of vague exceptions to their religious freedom promise in their constitution, except when it violates religious order or public safety or something like that. And part of that comes from international covenants, which also has vague language like that that's not been well defined by international courts. And I hope that's something the center can really look at, because trying to get clear language and tougher standards about what constitutes upsetting the social order and those kinds of things would be a significant advance in protecting religious freedom across the globe. And they allowed us to put together a group of international scholars. It was led by Cole Durham here, and he went over and met with them, and they listened. And they really considered a lot of the issues that everyone was raising. And they went from a second draft and a third draft and fourth draft and draft 5. And then for some reason went to 5A, 5B, 5C, and then to draft 7. I have no idea why the sequence was that way. And then 8, 9, 10, and this is draft 11. This is draft 11. And in this draft, if you want to hold any of those religious activities in your church, you have to get government approval still. The first year. And every year after that, all you have to do is notify the government. You don't have to wait for approval. You want to send a kid to seminary, ordain them, hire them, move them around, just have to notify the government under the new law. now religious organizations, religious entities, will for the first time have legal personality. They will be able to own property, to open bank accounts for the first time. If this law goes through as it is, it doesn't mean there aren't still concerns we have about religious freedom, particularly in the rural areas, in the ethnic rural areas, the Hmong and the Khmer areas, here where there are still significant harassment from local authorities. That's not going to go away overnight because the new law is passed. But this is going to make life better for millions of people, millions of religious observers in that country if it goes through. It was supposed to be voted on today. They have postponed it till tomorrow. And all of the work that good people, like the people at the International Center for Law and Religion, that good people from the International Contact Group, this coalition of 30 countries, the Canadians and we helped coordinate, of countries from across the globe who want to work together and reinforce each other's work on behalf of religious leader, all of religious liberty, all of the efforts of the indigenous populations in that country, including the Mormon Church, who have expressed their concerns and hopes to the government to ease restrictions that would make life easier for them. We're going to see tomorrow. There may be a true breakthrough in these areas. And again, I say that knowing there will remain serious problems still. There is a provision now for the first time that clarifies that religious groups can open social service projects and programs and run them. They're already allowing that to happen. That bishop up in the Highlands, the credit of the government, they allowed him to build the two biggest orphanages, I believe, in the country that he ran up there. That wasn't true of many dioceses, it was of this one. So what the local authorities do makes a real difference. And one of the things we've urged the government to do, if they make these improvements, is that training programs for the local and regional officials, so they understand exactly what the changes in the law mean to them. Now, I tell you this at some length, both to exemplify the kinds of problems the religious communities face, but also to give you a sense of how we go about our work. Here, I will say one other thing that every country that I go to, if I can, I meet with the Minister of Security. They are crucially important. A lot of repression that happens, a lot of restrictions that happen against religious freedom are done in the name of security threats that have to be responded to. I mean, think of China's response or efforts at independence or autonomy that these groups have, because ethnic and tribal and religious groupings often overlap. And therefore, in Vietnam, concerns about the Khmer and the Hmong and some of the groups who had fought with the Americans against the North Vietnamese, and they believe still harbor separationist tendencies. They want to keep tight control over this. So we worked very closely every time I went there to speak to the Minister of Security as well. And he was really open on these things, you know, pointed out the obvious. You move from an approval system to a notification system, he's going to know everything he knew under the approval system. He wasn't doing the approvals. Another ministry was doing the approvals. He wants the information. It's the same under a notification system as it is under the approval system. And those security needs, and now many may feel government shouldn't make people report, religious groups report what they're doing. That's inherently a limitation on religious freedom, and it is here. And someday I hope that won't be a requirement. But when we knew that those security interests were going to be an obstacle to changes, this was an important point to lift up and get attention to. That in terms of what they wanted to know, they would know as much under the notification as the approval system. And I'll almost always meet it. Understanding the concerns of the security ministry really helps us make recommendations that will that have a shot at really getting through. And it may take time, but no one's more patient than the Mormon churches about trying to see improvements happen about this. And we've tried to take a similar kind of stance in understanding. We always put markers down. We'll always say, Pakistan, we are against blasphemy laws. We think they're wrong. But at least start under your own laws to enforce the laws against false accusations of blasphemy that are so terrifying to non-Muslim minority groups in the country. They know how to protect themselves from saying something that would be considered blasphemous. They don't know how to protect themselves from false accusations of blasphemy. So what's achievable? What's doable? So I tell you the Vietnam story, A, because the center here played a very constructive role in helping the government of Vietnam think about different options and understand what the problem of some of the laws as they were written, as they were drafted, would have raised for religious freedom. But also because it gives you an insight into the way we go about our work as well. So I run the International Religious Freedom Office. We produce the annual report. That annual report covers 199 countries and territories across the globe. I just want to say a word about the impact of the report. I hope all of you have a chance to just go online. You can Google the words State Department, Religious Freedom Report, and whatever country you're interested in, and take a look at it and see how the report is put together for that country. We do an overview, we say what the law is, we talk what government laws and practices are, we talk about social hostilities and assess what the government is doing to stop social hostilities, and then we talk what the United States government is doing on behalf of religious freedom in these countries. The embassy and the people from my office and others in the State Department who are engaged in this effort as well. So we issue that report, and I want you to think about this for a minute. I travel around to countries, and I meet with oppressed minorities, and they'll say, you know, we're 1,000 people in a country of 30 million people. We're facing enormous repression. We have no one to turn to, no one who knows our story. And you hold our story up to the world. You bring international attention to our plight. And human rights lawyers will use our reports to introduce as evidence of violations of international law when they file cases in their courts. And other foreign ministries who don't do such a report, we're really the only ones who do anything quite like ours. Germany just began last year, the next country to take up the idea of doing a report, but they focus on only a specific number of countries each year. And I'm glad they do it, and we're encouraging them to do it. But a lot of other countries simply take our report, send it out to their political officers and their embassies, and say, here's a blueprint of the problems of religious freedom. Why don't you be in touch with these religious minorities that are described as having problems here? See what you can do to help. Reach out to the other embassies, the U.S. embassy and other embassies. See if you can work with them to meet with the government and encourage the government to make changes. And I have to confess, we didn't think of this, the most obvious impact. We didn't think of it when we wrote the law 20 years ago. And if every year there are 200 political officers, foreign service officers in the political section, of every embassy, and frankly, there are more because in a number of the large countries, the consulate staff also assigned someone in their human rights division to political division in human rights work to focus on this. They have to go out and speak to the people, to the religious leaders of the communities. They have to find out what's happened this past year that has to go in the report. They have to go to the government officials and engage with them because we always put the government side of the story of what's happening. So we hear from these oppressed groups we never had anyone to talk to before. Now there's this person from your embassy who's reached out to us, connected with us, we become friends. We go to her or to him when we have a problem and we need someone to intervene on our behalf. But cumulatively, those couple of hundred people, year after year after year, some do it more than 1 year, can do it 2 or 3 years, but cumulatively, there are a couple of thousand Foreign Service officers who have had to immerse themselves in religious liberty issues. And that has created a degree of religious liberty literacy in the American Foreign Service Corps that makes a profound difference and makes our work a lot easier. Many of those people began as political officers 17 years ago are now ambassadors or deputy chiefs of mission here. So on top of that, we do training programs at the Foreign Service Institute for staff and for DCMs and ambassadors. And we do training programs regionally around the world for these people. So this has really resulted in a much stronger degree of understanding about religious liberty challenges, what can be done about it, what international law requires, how we go about our work, and made really very effective partnerships between our embassies around the globe and the headquarters at the State Department as well. So we're extraordinarily proud of what has been achieved here. But with all of that, this is not a great time for human rights and religious freedom across the globe. We know that there are growing problems in many areas where we're seeing more authoritarian regimes cutting down on the space that civil society can function in general, that human rights groups can function, that media can function, dissenters ending up in higher numbers in jail. And it's such a time where we have to expand our work and intensify our work. And we do. And we can't change everything overnight. But where you can change a law in a country, millions of people's lives are going to be better. Where you can get a political prisoner out of jail, the life of somebody who is being jailed simply for living out their religious conscience has been saved. Where you can build interfaith coalitions, you can help create structures that will change the country in the long run. Think of Sri Lanka and Burma, both of which lived under military backed regimes that were highly repressive, both of them in recent years being able to move to a more open society through democratic elections here that make a difference. It was years of the international community investing in nurturing, supporting, training civil society in those countries that helped create the conditions that helped bring about those changes, together, of course, with the courage of those who fought, often at the risk of their lives or imprisonment, for greater freedoms within those countries. It's a long-term engagement in which we're involved, but every time we make a difference, it is a blessing to those who have been oppressed and persecuted, and it is a source of hope for others around the world that someday their day to freedom may come. Thank you very much.